Al-Qaeda and the Taliban are interconnected. And if the Taliban succeed, Al-Qaeda comes back with them into Afghanistan, number one. And number two, if the Taliban succeed, it's a worldwide propaganda victory. And I can tell you, the thousands, tens of thousands of young Muslims will rally to the cause of Al-Qaeda and the Taliban and increase the danger to our country and to the Netherlands and to our allies if that happens. I think it's clear that any weakening of the effort against the Taliban increases the danger to all of us. And as I've said before, and I'll say it again, Amsterdam can just as easily be a target as New York or Washington, London or Madrid.
Richard Holbrook seems very worried of the Afghan issue. For the moment, any solution to the bloody conflict that dominates this country is beyond his grasp. Support for our military presence there is crumbling, and Washington is struggling to convince its partners of their usefulness and necessity. What was the original objective again? What do we do if we stay? We invited four specialists to answer these questions, and we visited the Taliban for the occasion. Our first stop is Karuk. It's been the symbol of Afghan independence ever since a rebel leader died here in the 19th century. We are welcomed by the main religious leader of this region, who is also one of the most influential intellectuals in the country.
Ono mardome mehmon dostian. Va dar talimat islami am ma darim ke mehmon ba har kas baad be o ehtiram bashe. Asan ma mehmon. Mehmon ba kasi megim ke دو میمون داریم ما. یک میمونی داریم که قبلا این بین ما او یک آشناییه و هدف از آمدن او یک زیارت و احترامی از ما و بس. یک میمون دیگه داریم که با وجود ناآشنایی یک آدم غریب و مسافر میآید و جایم نداره و ما او شبی به این میمون به او خدمت میکنیم. یک کسانی که روی یک هدف می آیند میگن اونا مهمان گفتن میشند اونا روی هدف و هدف دارند. این رمز موفقیت در صبر و استقامت. رمز موفقیت. طبعا آدم نابلد به چه میفته.
Today, more than 65,000 soldiers from 42 countries are on active duty in Afghanistan. Obama is about to send another 30,000 over. In 2001, these forces operated in and around Kabul. Now, 9 years later, they're all over the country hunting down the enemy, the Taliban.
Hey, no problem, man. It's always been fun. Look, the question is, what are we, the West, doing in Afghanistan? Why are we there? Are we there to show our support for NATO and be patted on the head by Obama? Are we there to bestow packages of human rights and democracy upon the poor Afghan people? Are we there as part of a huge, epic political story, which most of us don't even understand? These packages of human rights and boxes of democracy that we bring, it's very good of us, it's a very good idea, but when you live in the Middle East, as I have for 33 years almost, you find that these great ideas drain away into the tribal sands.
I think, you know, you are there, you know, depending on what day of the week we are. You will say you are there out of international solidarity, out of a human concern for the Afghan people, that you are there for your own security, because Afghanistan has been and may be again the source of terrorism. It is already also the source of drugs. The drugs that are sold in Europe all come from Afghanistan. So there are selfish reasons for you to be there, and there are less selfish reasons for you to be there. There is also, you know, the geopolitical situation. Until perhaps 2001, people in your part of the world were thinking of Afghanistan as a faraway country, a small country, and if people want to kill one another, why not let them do it? You know, it doesn't affect anybody. I think now everybody realizes that, you know, globalization works in every possible way, not only for finance and Coca-Cola. You know, the Americans mainly, frankly, were in Afghanistan for revenge. They were looking for the people who had attacked them, and they had no interest for Afghanistan. The Europeans were following the Americans. They had come there out of solidarity. I don't think anybody really took the time to understand what was happening in Afghanistan.
We are in Kabul to see Mullah Wakil Ahmed Mutawakil, former foreign minister of the Taliban regime and right-hand man of Mullah Omar. The Americans imprisoned him for 18 months. Then he spent 3 years under house arrest. Interviews with this man are a rare occurrence.
Afghanistan jangahay mukhtalif dashtan wa jangahay turani dashtan wa li filhal jangi ajib gharib dar ki har do taraf afghana astan wa li da pahlo har taraf afghana ghairi afghana ham astan. اگر ناتو میگه که ما ایساف هستیم یعنی حفیظ صلح هستیم این تعریف نداره حفیظ صلح وقتی گفته میشه که دو طرف در جنگ باشد یک کشور طرفی حائل یا طرفی منجی بیان هر دو طرف از جنگ خلاص کنن دور کنن او پرده شود بین دو طرف فعلا اینا که آمدن دو پهلوی یک طرف جای گرفتن طرف دیگران توپک برابر کردن یعنی با یک جنگیدن با یک طرف یعنی فعلا گفته نمیشه که اینا حافظ صلح هستن.
We now have 22 times as many military personnel in the Muslim world than the Crusaders had in the 12th century. You see, the real problem, to my mind, is this. We are trying to produce in Afghanistan this special democracy, this wonderful society that will be a glittering symbol of our ability to help the third world, as we used to call it, or development, or whatever. But when you come down to it, our efforts to open schools in these remote villages, which the Russians tried to do totally hopelessly, in vain, the schools were burned just like they are now, is a bit like trying to persuade Oliver Cromwell or Henry VIII or the Duke of Alba, in your case, of the benefits of democracy or the rules of war. You know, I mean, Oliver Cromwell would chop your head off and get on with the war, wouldn't he? I think societies have to develop on their own. We can help them learn how to make modern bridges. They know how to build bridges. They've been doing it for centuries before we got there. But we can't, I think this goes throughout the Muslim world. We cannot go to the Muslim world always with our soldiers and our tanks and our Apache helicopters. It doesn't work. And we're always going there saying we're coming to produce a new freedom. We're going to help the... In 1842, we thought we were helping the barbarous Afghan people, and they thanked us by destroying an entire English army on the Kabul Gorge.
We travel on, leaving the big city and the main roads behind us. This is Taliban country. Driving around here without an invitation is extremely dangerous. We are guests here, so our safety is supposed to be guaranteed. Our guide arranged a meeting with the leader of this province. His basement contains state-of-the-art equipment for communicating with the Taliban up in the mountains. Our guide returns empty-handed. We have no permission to film.
The Taliban, I think nobody talked to them. And I think if we had talked to them, probably they wouldn't have come. And at any rate, the Americans wouldn't have allowed it. So their absence was something that we needed to remember, that the Taliban, who until then controlled 90 or 95% of the territory, were not there. We have got to be aware of that. But we had to accept that they couldn't be there. Yeah. But what we could have done is really ask ourselves some very basic questions. The Taliban have been routed and left the cities. They didn't surrender to anybody. They didn't sign any surrender document to anybody. So where were they? What were they thinking? What they were planning? We should have asked those questions immediately.
Traditionally, Herat is the most conservative town of all Afghanistan. Islamic rules determine all aspects of daily life here. Haj Mullawi Qaradat, connected to the Taliban government back in the mid-1990s, is still the head of all local religious leaders today. Ten kilometers south of Herat, Qaradat established a Quranic school,